Kiwi is 16 minutes past nine.
The Radio Wemo Breakfast.
Live from the New Scientist Labs, Janine Young, newscientist.com.
Yep, the New Scientist Lab just keeps on moving around the world. Last week was Scotland. This week it's Paris with Janine Young. Hello to you, Janine.
Good morning.
How is the beautiful, lovely, romantic city of Paris?
Wet and grey, got to say. It's autumn in the Northern Hemisphere at the moment, so it's, of course, never going to be quite as nice as it's starting to get in my lovely home city of Melbourne. However, Paris is a lovely city. I went and saw an exhibition today of Claude Monet's work at the Grand Palais, and it was just stunning. It's the best collection of Monet that has been collected in two dozen years. It's amazing. So if anyone's coming to Paris, come to the exhibition. It's well worth it.
Check that out. Of course, it's a very ancient city. Do you get interested in all the old stuff?
I do. I actually went to an archaeological crypt, which is out in the courtyard of Notre Dame yesterday. And you can actually see evidence of the Gallo-Roman walls, and you can see the old medieval buildings. It's not very big, but it's enough that the archaeological nerd in me just got really excited and went, oh, man, this is really cool. Because it is. It's not often that you get to see the remains of the Romans, particularly in cities like Paris, because everything's just kept being built on. So to have any of it exposed is actually cool. And cities come and go, and levels of streets change, and so do alignments of roads.
Yeah.
So pretty cool stuff.
And I suppose Paris is probably at the opposite end of the scale of the first story that we're going to be talking about, and that is almost the city of the future, the city with a brain, Janine.
This sounds a little bit like when you think about it, iRobot or HAL from 2001 A Space Odyssey. The fact that a city may have an all-seeing, all-knowing, all-controlling computer at the centre of it. There's a city that's been designed in Portugal, just outside of Paredes, a city sort of on the same line as Porto. And what they're planning on doing is making this a truly sustainable city. They want to make it have a system that's based very much on the human body. So it's going to have a central nervous system. It's going to have a controlling brain, a computer, a set of kidneys, effectively, a stomach, because it's actually going to eat its own waste, but we'll get there in a minute. But the whole idea is that you do have this central controlling mechanism. It works out how much water is in the tanks. And if you know that you have a really hot day, it's going to adjust the energy usage for cooling and the like. The idea is that instead of actually using air conditioning on really hot days or when it's cloudy, what they can do is instead take stored energy in the form of ice and blow cool air across that, because blowing a fan uses less energy than using air conditioning, for example. And they can actually then cool buildings using the ice. So it's actually stored energy, and it's been used in a completely different way. If the water tanks from one building have gotten low, they can ship it from another building. So the whole idea is that the eyes and ears of this city are residing in this central computer, and it can regulate things, activities, water, electricity, generation, as well as use, right across the entire city. It's quite an extraordinary concept.
Yeah, so it basically takes out all the inefficiencies that currently exist in most major cities around the world. There's a lot of waste, isn't there?
There's a vast amount of waste. Incredible figures, like about only 3% of the water that we need to use in a city is for anything like cooking or for drinking. So a lot of the water that goes down, say, the sewer system, or goes down stormwater drains and the like, often at the moment just flows straight out to sea or is minimally treated and, you know, kind of disappears. A lot of inefficiencies there. What they're thinking about doing with this city is taking, for example, roof gardens. They're going to be covered in anything like bamboos or any other kind of organism plants that are able to kind of filter the water out, get rid of all the nasties. It's a natural filtration system, and reuse the water for flushing toilets. Cooking water can also be really used for flushing toilets and the like. We don't need drinking quality water to be able to wash our clothes and to flush our toilets and the like. So it's actually removing those sorts of inefficiencies that will make a big difference. The stomach that I talked about eating its trash properly. It's rubbish. We recycle only, I think, about 5 or 10% of what's out there at the moment. And if you're able to be more efficient with how you use your waste, whether it be the stuff that we produce as humans, and indeed we talked a few weeks ago about using urine as an energy source, but just breaking down anything that's in there to be able to use it more efficiently. Recycling isn't necessarily the best way to go. If you clear a lot of the organic material off materials and then you burn them at 400 degrees without oxygen, you can actually generate biochar, which can then be used as a fertilizer. Yeah. So there's a number of different ways that you can actually use the stuff that we have in our lives a lot more efficiently, and that's what this city is trying to get towards, and it should apparently be completed by 2015, and it'll be the first of its kind that will be completed. There's one in Abu Dhabi and another one being discussed in China. Those are nowhere near completion. In fact, China hasn't even started construction yet. Mm. So they're talking about this being the first of its kind, and it will be a proof of concept.
Cool, that's really exciting. On to the next story, something called, a nice wee tool called Audio Zoom that picks out a voice in the crowd. Sounds kind of freaky as well.
This also sounds a bit scary as well. You know, Hal coming over the system again. Mm. You know, 2001 being prescient, who knew? This idea came from a couple of physicists who had the idea of being able to take a number of microphones in a circular array, a pattern, in a sports ground. So it's currently being tested in a basketball stadium. We have video on our website to sort of show how it picks out different conversations. So 300 of these microphones in a circular array at the top of a basketball arena, and they have a fixed camera in the center of it. What they do is zoom in on one person. It could be the coach, it could be a player, it could be the referee, it could be, you know, the celebrity that's sitting in the crowd and having a fight with their partner. It could be anyone. Yeah. This is the really scary part.
Yeah.
And because they can actually work out the time that it should take for the voice to get to and from each of the microphones, you're effectively amplifying that voice. When you have, say, three microphones trained on the celebrity, you're going to have more power to pick it up. Imagine having 300 microphones trained on that person.
Wow.
It's remarkable how clear each of the conversations are. You can hear the coach going, oh, that was a bad call. And even more amazingly, you can hear the bubblegum popping of the guy sitting next to him.
Oh, amazing. I mean, this obviously has implications for privacy, but it also has, the potential to be applied in crime fighting. I think everyone's seen sort of the classic mafia dramas or something where they don't want to talk indoors because they think that the walls might be bugged or the phone's bugged, so they go out and talk in the middle of a sports field. But even in that situation, you could now possibly still be heard.
Oh, it'd be even easier in the middle of a sports field where there's nobody else, because the whole idea about this technology is that they can pick it up through a crowd of a couple of thousand people. And you've got the noise in the background, but because you're trained on one person, it's actually picking up that conversation amongst all the background noise. So the mafiosi are in real trouble if they're in the middle of an empty stadium, because it's going to be crystal clear.
Yeah. just another piece of technology and kit that takes away just that little bit of extra privacy that we think that we have, Janine.
Just watch yourself. I think that's the point.
Yeah. How much longer in Europe for you?
I go back to London on Saturday afternoon and I fly home to Melbourne on Sunday night. So next week you will go back to seeing the view of Port Melbourne out my window, not my best friend's flat in Paris.
Well, at least it should be a little bit warmer. Thanks so much, Janine.
See you next week.
Janine Young, of course, is our new scientist correspondent, joining us there from Paris today. And those stories you'll find in the New Scientist magazine coming out next week. Also,